So, this chapter is a quick introduction to the language of categories and functors. What we are going to do is just a limited introduction. An interested reader may look into the book I have referred to at the end of this by three authors. One of them is Adam X. This book is freely downloadable and it is quite a readable book. The topic, as I have told you, language. So to master language, of course, it needs some time. So I won't say that right now you will become master of whatever I am going to introduce here, though that itself is very minimal. But because I'm going to use this language again and again, certainly by the end of this course, I hope you will all know how to use this language. Doing categories and functors as a theory itself is not at all done here. You must be careful about that. I am just, you know, it is not like we are going to write poetry in this language. We are just trying to learn the market language of, you know, how to do day-to-day business. That's all. All sciences are essentially study of patterns. This is more so in mathematics. The fundamental concepts such as number and space combine to produce innumerable patterns that we come across in day-to-day life. All mathematical concepts involve a certain family of objects which fit into a pattern. And then the study involves relations among us these objects. Let us consider some examples. In topology, we study the so-called topological properties of topological spaces. The objects that we consider here are topological spaces, but the relations are amongst them is what are called as continuous functions. The fundamental property of continuous functions is that the composite of two continuous functions is a continuous function. And identity map from the space to itself is also continuous. Okay. Similar statements can be done about groups. Suppose you are studying groups, then what are the functions from one group to another group you are going to study? They will be homomorphisms. Once again, composite of homomorphisms is again a homomorphism, and identity map from the group to the group itself is also a homomorphism. Okay, we can go on listing such examples like vector spaces and linear maps, modules over a ring, and then the module homomorphism, which are called linear maps again. And so on. Okay, so what we shall do is give a strictly rigorous definition of categories and then re-examine some of these examples again in the light of this definition, which extracts certain basic properties that we are trying to explain. Category is a language that sums up this aspect of mathematics in a technically precise way. Not surprisingly, it can help you prove theorems also. This chapter is divided into, let us say, four sections briefly. First section, you will see definition of a category and sufficiently many examples. Second, And third, we will study relations between them under the name of functors. In 4 and 5, we see some more examples of certain standard notions which can be expressed, which have been expressed, which have been studied without the categorical language. But when you put them in the categorical language, how nice it becomes. Okay, so with this background, let us begin with some brass tacks. A category C consists of, like I can say, it is a ordered quadruple, the four things. But I do not want to use that kind of language. So it consists of an object C. So they are C objects, you can say. Okay, what it is, it will come in the definition. The whole definition has to be understood before you understand anything, any particular thing. So what are the properties? One by one, I am going to list. To each ordered pair AB of objects A comma B, okay, so A comma B are members of this whatever this class. We don't say this is set, that is a slight difference here. It's a collection, or you can say a class, but not a set. But what makes sense is whether some other objects A and B belong to that or not. This belonging relation is well defined. That is the meaning. Suppose you take two members of this class, then assigned to that is another set. This time it is a set. MAB is a set. And what is the property of this set? MAB, MA prime B prime, they are disjoint unless A is equal to A prime and B equal to B prime. So this equality must make sense inside C. Okay, what is the meaning of two objects are equal? That is also understood. These are all axioms. These are all part of the definition. Each word, each comma here is a part of the definition. Okay, the elements of MAB are called morphisms. What do you mean by element? That this relation, this epsilon here, which I have written, belonging sign. A and B belonging to this is equal to saying elements of. Elements of this sphere is elements of MAB. This is a set, so we know, we understand what are the elements of AB. These are called morphisms with domain A and codomain B. A morphism is a domain A and a codomain B. Okay. Now here is a practice. This is only a matter of what we do in practice. It's not a part of the definition. We don't need the part of it. Following practice, we follow the usual practice of writing F from A to B whenever F is inside MAB. This is imitating, if A and B are sets, F a function from with domain A and codomain B, then we write this symbol, right? So that we are following as a matter of practice. This does not mean that A and B are sets and F is function. Okay, what does mean? This F belongs to MAB of this category. So that is the meaning of this whenever you write like this. Okay, so definition is not yet over. So only one condition I have expressed this much. Now, part two says, if you take a triple of objects, then this MAB, MBC, MAC, these are all sets now. There's a binary operation from MAB cross MBC to MAC. Now these are all sets, so binary operation makes sense. So I can write it as F comma G going to G composite F. Okay, G is here. So that will come on this side, the standard practice of F comma G going to G composite F is the binary operation. These binary operations are for each triple there is one. Okay, so if you change that triples and so on, there will be many such binary operations. They are collectively associative. What is the meaning of collectively associative? In the following sense, namely, F from A to B, G from B to C, H from C to D, then we have G composite F, right? We also have H composite G. These two things make sense. So what we want is G composite F and then followed by H behind. Then H of G composite F is same thing as H composite G first and then following the other side, namely composite with F. So brackets can be interchanged like this. As usual, this is the associativity. The point is that they are not functions from, you know, same set to same set or something. So the compositions may not be defined unless the arrows match as usual, just like in the case of sets. Okay, the third condition is that for each object A and C, there exists a unique ID A, this is notation, inside MAA. MAA are morphisms from A to A. There is one unique element there which has the property that it is a two-sided identity. For all F from A to B and all G from C to A, you have F composite identity, this makes sense, equal to F, identity composite G equal to G. So this identity of A is a two-sided identity, okay, is the meaning of this one. Okay, morphism A to B is called an equivalence. This, now I am defining equivalence in the category C. Okay, or you may say invertible. Okay, this word is also being, you know, defined. If there exists a morphism G, morphism means what? An element of MBA. Okay, so I can write it as in this notation. Okay, such that G composite F, F composite G is identity of B, G composite F is identity of A. Then G is said to be the inverse of F. In fact, you can say this is an inverse, but now it is elementary algebra that you have to verify that this inverse as well as the identities are unique. Here identity is already axiomatized as unique. Uniqueness actually follows. Okay. Similarly, the inverse will be also unique if it exists. There may not be an inverse. So if there is an equivalence or invertible map from A to B, then we say A and B are equivalent objects, okay, in the category. Okay, that is the end of the definition. So we have defined what is a category, what is a morphism in it, what are objects in it, what is an invertible map, and what are equivalences. Okay, now I want to make a few elementary remarks. Often, when more than one category is involved in the discussion, we write, instead of just MXY, we write MCXY, morphisms XY, instead of that, home MCXY, that C is indicated. Here also, morphism CXY should be to denote the set of all morphisms from X to Y, where X and Y are considered as objects in a particular category. Suppose I am having two different categories. Then if I just say morphism XY, you don't know whether it is in category C or category D, right? So that's why in that case we write. Otherwise, when the discussion is going on, a particular thing, we understand and then we reduce the notation as usual. This is a practice. But this kind of thing should not be done when you are dealing with a computer or something. Computer won't understand the cat unless you define writing. Till here, till we redefine, this is this one. That's what you have to define like that and so on. Okay. By the way, the computer scientists use the category theory very much. Okay. So it follows easily that identity morphism is unique in MEMA for all A. What we have seen is there exists one, but now you can prove, and you should, okay, try your hand, that it is unique. You can't have two different identities. All that, note that MAB is a set, may or may not be empty. If MAA, if you take, it is non-empty because identity is there. But otherwise, MAB may be empty, may not be empty. It's not necessary that it's non-empty. Whereas object C need not be sets. Okay? So we will see some examples later on. Neither is the collection of objects. Of course, this is definitely, most often it's not a set. You need not bother about these purely logical problems at this stage. That is the key word here, because if you get into that, you will never learn how category theory. Category theory, you should keep learning. Whether you call it a class or a set and so on, you should bother about only when you are talking about foundational mathematics like logic. The logicians are more interested in this aspect of that, okay? Till then, you will not have any problems. You should not bother about that one, okay, right now. Otherwise, you will never learn the subject. It also follows that if f is invertible, then inverse is unique, therefore I can use the notation f inverse. Any G such that F composite G and G composite F are identity of the corresponding domain or codomain. Okay, that G will have to be the same. Therefore, you can write G as F inverse. The equivalence of any two objects defines an equivalence relation, namely reflexive, transitive, and symmetric. So you can verify this. And what one would like to do, one of the central problems in category theory is, when you have defined all these categories, whether given two objects, they are anywhere near being equivalent. So if you know all equivalence classes in the particular category, you will pretend to know that I know this category complete. Okay? So that is, pattern studying is precisely what science is all about. So one more remark is the condition of disjointness. Remember, I tell MAB, MA prime, B prime are different and disjoint unless A is equal to A prime and B is equal to B prime. There is no overlap among them. That is very important here. Right now you may not understand the importance of this, because in standard mathematics that we keep studying in calculus and so on, right from the days of Euler, Gauss and so on, we have to keep that practice, hasn't been given up, okay? Maybe for good, we haven't given up. Namely, for example, I will give you, we write sine function. The sine function could be, when you are doing just the real world sine function, it could be just function from R to minus 1 plus 1, okay? But you can treat it as a function from R to R also, or still you write sine. Then there is a complex valued sine function defined all over the complex number C. For that also you write sine, okay? In all these three, for example, are denoted by sign. You take a function, then you restrict it to a subset, you use a sign. You take a function A to B and treat B inside C, okay, the function still written as A to C, the same function. Okay. This practice is, I have admit, denote all writing all these three as sign, okay, which is a sin according to categorical language. This is not allowed. If you change the domain R to codomain minus one plus one, you change any one of them, the function there you take will not be nothing to do with the function in the other side. Okay, they are disjoint elements. So this is what we have to insist. So, however, as I have told you, cutting down clumsy notations for all these things may obscure the way we do mathematics. Okay, but for example, this is not at all done in computer science, computers. Okay, on the other hand, one of the basic objects of language of category theory is to provide us rigor without being too verbose. To achieve this one, right in the beginning, it is very, very verbose, like insisting on having MAB and A prime, B prime disjoint all the time and so on. In the beginning, you very, very verbose, then you will see the reward coming. You know, you just tell one single statement, it will mean 50,000 theorems. That is the kind of you know, achievement which category theory has done. Okay, all right. Let C be a category. What is the meaning of a subcategory? That's what I'm going to define now. Okay, a subcategory, we mean a category D satisfying the following condition. So D is going to be a category by itself. But what is its relation with C is what we are going to see. Each object of D is an object in C also. For each pair of objects AB inside D, the set of morphisms from A to B is a subset of set of all morphisms, C morphisms from A to B. That is MD AB is a subset of MC AB. The third thing is the binary operation inside D is the same as the binary operation inside C. Okay, similar to, you can see that what is the meaning of subgroup and so on, or what is the meaning of subspace and so on. All that is included in a subcategory. Okay, further, if equality holds in this one, namely, once A and B are inside D, MD of AB is equal to MC of AB. If this happens for all pairs of A and B, whenever A and B are inside D, then we call D as a full subcategory. So we will have examples of this, no problem. Right now, we will have examples of categories. As you might have guessed, the foremost and the easiest category, which one calls is a mother of many, many categories, mother of the idea of category, and that is denoted by ENS. ENS is a short form for ensembles, which is a French word. It just means sets. Take the collection of all sets. That is the object of this category, the object set. Okay, what are the morphisms? Morphisms are the usual set functions. So verification of the axioms is totally easy because the axioms have been modeled on what is happening in the sets. Okay, so we will see that many other examples that we are going to discuss, they are all in some sense subcategories of this category. That is why I call this as mother category. So the next category, I will give you a very simple one. Consider category, single object. How to denote this object? Put it as just a star. There is only this object. It has no structure, nothing, but it is an object. Okay? Then I have defined a morphism. So where do I have to define morphisms? From star to star. So M star star, right? I have defined. Take that also as a single element. You have to take a single element without, because the axiom says that MAA has to be non-empty. And what element I have to put? The identity element. Identity morphism. What is the meaning of this identity? It must be two-sided identity, blah, blah, blah. So the composition is also well defined here, namely identity, composite identity has to be identity. There is no other choice. Okay. So this is the, in some sense, the smallest category. Maybe one can make a category out of empty objects also. I am not going to discuss, but that is also allowed. Okay, empty objects. Other than that, this is a nice category. Sometimes the category theorists write this as one. The empty object as zero. Okay, I am not going to do all that, but I am aware of such things. Okay, the opposite category. The opposite category means there is a category already. See, I am going to construct a category which is called COP, the opposite category. What is it? Objects of opposite category are the same as the objects of the original category. See, but whenever A and B are members of this category, COP of M of COP, what are the morphisms from A to B? They will be the morphisms from B to A. Okay. And the composition law is the same except you write it in the opposite direction. So you can easily verify that identity, left identity becomes right identity becomes left identity. So identity will be there. Two-sided identity, no problem. Okay, associativity also no problem. So these are all easy to verify. Not only that, if you take COP, to take opposite of this opposite category, then what you get is C category. So this looks like a totally useless thing, but some of the very deep results are used by just doing this kind of thing in category theory, namely what are called as duality principles. We won't have time for discussing that one, but just important, because of the importance of this in general category, I have just introduced this this very simple idea of constructing it in the of category which is opposite category. Similarly, the singleton category is also, it is very important in that sense. We may not have much use of them. The category of topological spaces is one, that is what we are interested in. We are all the time in. What are the objects? All topological spaces. That collection, by the way, it is not a set. Okay? Collection of all topological spaces is not a set, but it is a class. What are morphisms? Continuous functions. Okay. What are the equivalences? Homeomorphisms. What are equivalence classes of objects? They are homeomorphism types. Okay. So this is the first example we started with even before the definition. So now we can see that it is a good example. The next category. Now you will see the power of categories, how one can just change a little bit and express lots of ideas. Consider a category whose objects are topological spaces. But morphisms from X to Y, X and Y are topological spaces, are not maps, continuous maps, but the homotopy class of a continuous. The homotopy class of a continuous map is treated as a morphism from X to Y. Okay? So this category is called homotopy category. So the elementary observations that if F is homotopic to G and H is homotopic to say H prime, then F composite H is homotopic to G composite H prime and so on. We have verified that, and those things are necessary to verify that this category makes sense. The composition is the same. F composite G, the classes is the same thing as you take F composite G, the class of that. Okay, what is a equivalence here? Homotopy equivalence. What are the equivalence classes of objects? Homotopy equivalent spaces. So suddenly, it has totally different meaning. Okay, and this is the category that algebraic topology is all the time interested in. Okay, so this can happen. Suppose you change the topological category slightly. There are various ways of changing it. Like you can take simplicial complexes, CW complex, I am going to discuss them, okay, or just Hausdorff spaces. Objects you have changed, just the only Hausdorff space you have taken. But continuous functions, you remain continuous functions. Or now only you can take homotopy classes, okay, and so on. So there is a lot of scope in this language, okay. So now these two categories are of importance. Simplicial category we have introduced in part one. Now we didn't have this terminology then. Now we have to just verify the terminology. CW category we introduced just a couple of days back. But what is this? Objects are topological spaces which have a structure, extra structure, namely a CW structure. A topological space itself is a set with an extra structure. Now we have one more extra structure, namely the CW structure. And what are the maps? Cellular maps. Composite of cellular maps is cellular. Identity map is always cellular. This is what I have to verify. And identity, we have said a two-sided identity. So that is a CW category. Similarly, the simplicial category in which morphisms are simplicial maps. Okay? So we will discuss more examples next time. Thank you.